Let's bust the myth of sativa versus indica. I'm Catherine Goldberg. Thousands of you have left comments on my videos saying that there is no difference between sativa and indica, that it's a marketing scam, it means nothing. If it means anything, it only has to do with the shape of the leaf. And I just want to set the record straight. That is not true. We're going to get into some really cool cannabis science today because the first cannabis genome was sequenced in 2011. I've loved genetics for a very long time, as well as neuroscience. And the question that I wanted to understand was how much variation is in the cannabis plant and what does that variation account for? But before we get into the science, I just want to give you guys some shopping tips because it's important to be practical, and it's frustrating that so many people spend money on cannabis that they think is going to make them feel one way because it's labeled a certain way, yet it doesn't make them feel that way. So it's true. The majority of what's sold in stores, commercial cannabis, which is sort of an oxymoron, to be perfectly honest, is a hybrid. It's been bred millions of times over, and it's a hybrid. They can slap whatever label they want on it. They can call it any strain they want. It's not like anyone's testing it. And they'll sell it to you. And of course, there's some brands that are, craft farms that take their genetics really seriously and they say what it is and they're honest. But most of the time, I would say don't depend on the label itself. You're going to need to look at the chemotype. And the chemotype is what's actually in the cannabis plant. And that's going to be revealed in the COA. So what we're looking at are we're looking at THC percentage. We're looking at if there's any CBD, and we're looking at minor cannabinoids. Are they existent? Are they non-existent? And then we're looking at terpenes. And this is why when people are like, there's no difference between sativa and indica. It makes no sense because all of those things are coded for genetically. So, like, of course, there's genetic variation. Again, so let's say you're going into the dispensary and you want something for sleep. You're going to look for a high THC. If it has CBD or CBN in it, CBN is just THC that's been degraded that makes you sleepy. You're going to look for terpenes like myrcene and linalool. If you're in any kind of pain, you might want to look for beta-carophyllene. And probably that might be labeled as an indica. Make sense? Let's say you want something for daytime use, for focus, that will just help you get your work done. You're probably going to want to look for a lower THC percentage because high THC is sedating. You're going to want to look for the minor cannabinoid THCV. It's rare, but it's popping up. And you may even want to look for CBG because CBG, as we'll talk about, there's a blog post coming out about this in a couple of days. It's good for focus. It's not speedy like THCV. It's good for kind of like long-term use. And then, in terms of terpenes, you're going to look for terpenylene, which a handful of people say that that's the sativa terpene that makes them feel anxious. I've also heard from a number of people with ADHD saying that's the terpene that allows them to focus. Different biology. You're probably going to look for pinene because that's good for focus. And you're going to look for limonene, which is good for like alertness. So, and that would typically be labeled sativa. So my question is, and why I wanted to do this episode is, well, like, why is it common that in sativas you get those three terpenes, terpenylene, limonene, and pinene, but it's more rare to get like linalool or myrcene? Like, could the genetic code have anything to do with that? So the fact is, it does. And it's always environment and genetics. So the difference between, and the most interesting thing I learned, to be perfectly honest, is that terpenes developed as systems for the plants to protect themselves. everything that we love about weed, the minor cannabinoids, the terpenes, the THC percentages, all of those develop to protect the plant so that the plant could reproduce and thrive. I'm specifically going to be talking about landrace strains before humans intervened, just so we can understand the differences. But so it basically where they grew determined the terpenes. So the plants that I love, the tall, lower THC energizing strains, right? Those developed in places that were really hot, that had a lot of sunlight, lots of sunlight. And the terpenes actually developed to keep bugs away, to keep fungi away. It was a mic antibacterial, which is really interesting. So all these ones that we have in traditional landrace sativas, terpenolene, limonene, and pinene, all were like natural bug sprays to keep the plants healthy, which is really interesting. Also, in those warmer climates, there was a lot of rain, which is why the plants had to be spaced out like more like the actual bud part of it, so that it wouldn't get moldy when the rain came. On the opposite side of the spectrum, we have landrace indicas that came from like Afghanistan, in northern India, Pakistan, places like that, where it was really cold and the elevation was really high. So you may have noticed that it seems like indicas have a higher THC percentage than sativas, not really in the dispensary anymore because it's all inflated. But traditionally, I was curious why that could be. The THC actually protected the plant from the harsh conditions of elevation and UV light. Isn't that kind of cool? And it's interesting also, so you have those plants that grew in colder climates. Those could flower in between 6 to 8 weeks. Then let's say you have a plant from a warmer climate. That could take up to 16 weeks to flower. You can see why no dispensary, cannabis business necessarily, would be super interested in having a plant that takes about twice as long and can grow up to 14 feet in the sky. So I have started working with a local farmer, and I've had the pleasure of smoking a real straight sativa. It felt like I smoked Adderall. I got so much done. It was amazing. Again, not something I've yet to find in the dispensaries in California, but if you know of good energizing sativas, please, as always, put them in the comments and I will compile them and put it out on the blog. The other thing I was curious about was, well, why does it seem like THCV is more common in the cannabis labeled sativa, when THCV, re I've never seen it in a cannabis that's labeled indica. And that's for two reasons. One is that the plant needed more time to grow and express its entire genetic potential. So after 6 to 8 weeks, there's no time for the THCVA to form. It takes up to those 16 weeks for that to come out. That's the first thing. Also, the THCV protected the plant under like really harsh lights for like the sun from the equator area. THC also protected the plants at a higher elevation in cold, so it goes both ways. I think that's really interesting. So yeah, I learned a lot about plant genetics and about this. Yes, there's only a 10 to 20% variation between the most racy sativa and the most sedating indica. And in that range is where like all the potential lies. So I'm going to end on something that I brought up before as science fiction, but the fact of the matter is we're not far away. So as I said, the cannabis genome has been sequenced. Genetic engineering and biochemistry have come a long way since 2011. We can write out genomes now, inject them into cells and have that play out. I'm not a geneticist. I just think it's cool. So, given that, oh, one other fact that I think is cool. So, also about why indicas traditionally have more THC, it's because they have more copies of the gene that makes THC. So, from a genetic engineering point, we're not that far away from saying, okay, well, I want a cannabis plant that has 8% THC, 8%, a 1-to-1 ratio. So maybe, yeah, like 8% CBD, right? So it's balanced. I want terpenolene, I want pinene, and I want limonene in it. So it's going to be great for daytime. It's going to give me energy. We're not that far away. And this also makes me really excited because through Savvy Relief, a lot of you have contacted me to work one-on-one to try to find the right strains based on where you live. And it seems like it's so difficult to find, first of all, these one-to-one balanced strains, either in flower or vape. And if you do find them, they don't necessarily have the terpenes that you need. I'm working with someone right now who has a very complicated pain case right now. And we're looking for a one-to-one, but also that has myrcene, linalool, and beta-carophyllene. If you know that strain, tell me, because she needs it. And it's hard to find. So I think we're really close to a point where we can tell a computer program how we want to feel. And based off of minor cannabinoids and terpenes, we might get something cool. You can't talk about genetics without also talking about the environment. So whether these terpenes will be expressed to their full potential is going to come down to the environment, to the light, to the nutrition, to the soil, if the cannabis is cured or if it's flash frozen. Environment and all the variables that that encompasses is basically what's going to determine if the genome can be expressed to its full potential. So it takes the seed and it takes a great farmer. So I hope you found this interesting. I found this really interesting. And I think it just helps all of us make more informed choices when we're talking about the cannabis we want, especially regarding daytime use when we don't want to be too tired and we do want to have energy and we want to be able to focus, because I think that's one of like the coolest uses for cannabis. And I know more and more of you are trying it out and finding it to be helpful as well. So thank you for listening. I really appreciate this. And if you want to hear more about cannabis science, just tell me and I will do a deep dive. Thanks for watching.